Nation and special guests, welcome to Eagle Up Friday, session 14. This one is titled Legacy. Before we get into our session, I just want to remind everyone about this Sunday's Merrill Forum. You know, so often we mention how, you know, our voice is not heard, but we have a platform this Sunday where the Merrill candidates are going to have to speak to issues that directly impact us, and that's education. So please make sure you have no excuse not to be in attendance, not to be present, not to ask questions, not to push these candidates to see what their platform is, you know, for something that directly impacts our community and our children. So please make sure everyone tunes in. And with that, I'm going to pass it over to Tyrone to do our morning libations.
This morning, I'm humbled to pour libation for two very extraordinary individuals. First, for President Biden, for winning the election and becoming the 46th president of the United States, and for his over 30 years of service in our government. And also for Madam Vice President Harris for making history as the first African-American, Asian-American, and female vice president, in the hopes that they're able to repair the destruction our former president has had on our country.
And we say,
Ashe, 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 Ashe. Ashe.
Brothers, this morning we also pour libation for the passing of Queen Mother, Miss Cicely Tyson, who transitioned to the ancestors yesterday at the age of 96. Miss Tyson was a true icon and pioneer who blazed the trail for so many African-American actors to follow. Although an aspiring actress at the time, she was publicly critical of movies and television programs that showed Black characters in a negative light and insisted we be portrayed on screen with dignity and respect. During her 70-year career, Ms. Tyson truly embodied the qualities of strength, power, class, and grace, and left this earth as a heralded queen in our community. Although we will miss her and mourn her passing today, we can also celebrate her magnificent life, as we know her spirit will always live on. It is in the memory of Tony, Emmy, and honorary Oscar award-winning actress, Miss Cicely Tyson, we pour libation this morning, and we say,
Ashe, Ashe, Ashe.
And as always, gentlemen, we always start with an academic component. So the fall semester came to a close last week. So we're gonna have new power rankings out, fellas. I just want to remind everyone that these are the top four seniors from across our network. These are the guys who kept it a buck 60 and better. So these are the top seniors. So it's going to be very interesting to see if these guys kept their position. We're going to have our new power score, Brinkley. Our new power score report is coming out next week. I'm sorry, in about 2 weeks, once we process all your grades. And the question for you guys and your parents, what's your scholar's power score? Did they take care of business in the fall semester when all the excuses were at hand? Or did they take care of business and increase their power score? Bring me. Next, bring me. And one of the things I want to talk to everyone about today, you know, in our opening song, we use Middle Child. And for me, that's such a powerful song because what it really speaks to is what the essence of Eagle is all about, which is mentoring. And in the song, you know, J. Cole, who's one of my favorite artists, kind of articulates the position of various levels of being a big brother slash middle child. He talks about Kodak Black, and we know very well about Kodak Black, who was just pardoned by then President Trump. We have J. Cole in the middle, who we can identify as the middle child. And for his song, he identified Jay-Z as his big brother. And one of the statements that he made in the song was the hope that someone like Kodak Black had more guidance. And when we think about our little brothers, not just your little brothers at home, when we think about the little brothers in our community, you know, we can identify those as individuals who may not be as informed. They haven't reached the point of full maturity. Sometimes, you know, they don't make the best decisions, very impulsive, can be unreasonable and irrational. And we all know individuals like this. It's no surprise. You guys know. But we also have that middle child, that person that's the go-between. the person that absorbs information, can pull from the big brother and get their words of wisdom, but also are in position to transfer that knowledge to the little brother. And I think that really speaks to where we're at right now in terms of the pandemic and in terms of what we've all been going through. So I just want to gauge where everyone is at, Brinley. So we have a poll question. So there are three types of brothers that we identified just now. We have the little brother in Kodak. There's so many questions that I have about what is going on in the world. I am constantly looking for guidance and how to process it. So that's Kodak in terms of the pandemic. We have the J. Cole / middle child. I find myself providing guidance to siblings, cousins, and others, but do not have time to access that same information, that do not have the same time to access the information that I do. At the same time, there's still so much I do not know, especially during the pandemic. And then we have the big brother. I feel comfortable and capable. Those who are struggling to make sense of what is going on in the world. The knowledge and experience I've shared with my siblings, cousins, and others have helped them during this time, during this crisis. So we can throw up that poll. Be honest. Not everybody's a Jay-Z. Not everybody's a big brother. But there are some times when you are Kodak. And that's all right. So be honest with this, fellas. And adults too, parents, educators, we all fall in one of these categories depending on the situation. Another 10 seconds. Brinley. Okay, so the vast majority of us on this call right now identify themselves as middle child. And there's such a responsibility in being considered a middle child, Brinley. There's so much responsibility. Your job is to take what the big brother is relaying to you, process your own, but also have a responsibility for your little brother. So sometimes your little bro and big bro all at once, and that puts you right in the middle. But in order to be the best middle child, you have to learn, you have to grow. You have to process what's going on around you. You have to seek out information. You have to seek out knowledge. You have to pay attention to those that have paved the trail prior to you coming on the scene. And that's why I'm so excited about our special guest today, Mr. Robert F. Smith, because he's gonna provide us with that big brother Jay-Z kind of information. That kind of dialogue that for some of us, we don't have access to. And that's what these sessions are about. These sessions are about providing you with the access and information in order to make the best decision possible, not just now, bring the two more slides over. Not just now, but in the future. You are going to be a post-pandemic big brother or big sister. What you learn now, what you process now and carry over, it's what's gonna impact future generations. You have a responsibility. We have a responsibility. So please make sure that you pay attention, you lock in, you focus in on what's gonna be discussed today, because it's gonna impact the kind of big brother or big sister you are in the future. And with that, I wanna introduce and kick it over to our president and CEO, Mr. David Banks.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Rashad Mead, for that. Young men of Eagle, as well as all the other young people who are joining us today from schools across New York City, you are in for a very, very special treat. And it is a particular privilege for me to be able to introduce our next special guest. We know that this is the 14th session of our Eagle Up Fridays. But there are none that are any more special than what we are about to experience. And with that, I want to introduce to you a very special person. Mr. Robert Smith is a legendary investor and visionary philanthropist. He was named by Forbes magazine in 2017 as one of the 100 greatest living business minds. And as Time magazine's 100 most influential people of 2020. He is the wealthiest Black man in the United States. I want you to hear that clearly. He is the wealthiest, not only black man, he is the wealthiest black person in the United States. Most of you may have heard of him in the news as the man who agreed to pay off the debt, the student debt of all the graduating class at Morehouse College in 2019. And even after his Morehouse pledge, Mr. Smith founded the Student Freedom Initiative to relieve the burden of student debt for STEM students at all HBCUs. He is the founder, chairman, and CEO of Vista Equity Partners, the investment firm that he started in 2000 to focus on investing in software companies. He has since built his company into one of the top performing private equity firms in the world. Listen to this. He employs over 70,000 people worldwide. Through his foundation, he has given a multi-million dollar level of support to the work of the Eagle Academy Foundation, and by extension has supported each one of you here today through our college readiness effort and the work of the Eagle Institute. On behalf of the 3,000 young men of the Eagle Academies and the hundreds of students from other schools who have joined us today to hear your remarks, our educators, school leaders, and staff, I want to extend my deepest gratitude, Brother Smith, for your investment in their future. And to say to all the young people, and particularly our young men at Eagle who are watching today, when you talk about the ultimate role model, this is who we're talking about. So now I would like to turn this over to our young men who will ask you a host of questions to begin our forum. Thank you.
Thank you for the wonderful welcome, Brother Banks. It is indeed my honor, my pleasure, my privilege to be here with all of you beautiful young men. I wish there was an Eagle Academy when I was growing up, but I am glad that there is one now. And I will do all that I can to continue to support what is the mission and the development of our beautiful African-American boys into this American economy. And I'm excited to continue to engage with the foundation, continue to engage with you young men to help you think about who you want to be and to help you realize those dreams and to frankly help enable you to serve our community and ensure that our community thrives, not just survives, but thrives in days, weeks, decades, and generations ahead. So I'm just very optimistic about who you all are. I'm excited to see what we're going to talk about today, and feel free to ask me any question. So thank you for welcoming, Brother Banks.
Thank you. Appreciate you so much.
Morning, Mr. Smith.
Good morning.
It's an honor to meet you. Thank you very much for taking the time to speak with us today. To meet someone who is as successful as you are and hearing about your life is invaluable. Can you please tell us about your journey and how you got to where you are today?
Sure. Thank you. Mitchell. I'm sorry. Mitchell, thanks for that question. I grew up in Denver, Colorado. And when I was growing up, people said, oh, they had black people in Denver. There were a few. I'll tell you what was interesting about growing up. I grew up in a community. And I think that's an important thing for you all to think about. A community isn't just a place that you live. It is a mindset of the people who are in that community. And it's one of taking care of each other. I was just beautifully struck by the question, are you a big brother or middle brother or little brother? And that's how our community operated. You know, we had the older kids who looked after the younger kids in the way that they helped us learn and teach and navigate the world. And then our responsibility as we got to be, you know, middle kids and older kids was to look after the younger kids as they were coming up in our community. That was the fabric that I think has formed and made me who I am. And it is a connectivity to the people that I care about and the people in my community. And that connectivity is one that as you become more capable, you can become more extensible. You can think about delivering what you can at bigger scale, but you can't do that if you haven't done your work. You can't do that if you haven't been able to to manage your life in a way where you can support your family and to support all the elements of your own health and welfare. And the most important part of that is your education. You're on a wonderful journey in starting from a great place in Eagle Academy. And from my perspective, it is your duty to extract all that you can from this institution in learning how to learn, learning how to be an exceptional student and an exemplary citizen in your community. That's a big part of what your responsibility is. And then of course your responsibility is to identify those younger than you, and they may actually be in your same class, but just not in the same place, and help them get to that same station. And then, you know, continue to extend your progress and your success going into college and becoming a professional. And then thinking about how you can deliver higher impact to your communities in ways that you have become expert. So I grew up again in a Black neighborhood, a community. My father, my mother were both school teachers. I remember, and I tell this story, it was at a time when they were desegregating schools. At that time, we were bused across town, and it just, and because of the racism that existed then and even now, when they started to desegregate schools, someone decided, some racists decided to burn one third of the buses that were going to be used for this desegregation effort. And so only one bus came to my neighborhood then because the others were destroyed. And so the kids that got on that bus, you know, went across town, and it was clear that we received a better set of resources to educate us. And I remember when we came home, you know, many of our, frankly, all of our parents worked, with the exception of a couple. And one of the women, she had us, every one of us, after school until our parents came home, you know, in her home, in her basement, and her kids, who were a little older than me, would teach us math. They would teach us reading. They would teach us science. We'd have some form of a wholesome snack, which was typically got kind of graham crackers and milk type of a thing. But I remember that because to me, that helped create the foundation of a community that cared, that understood that our parents had to work. Our parents often worked far away from our homes, had to travel there in public transportation or drive or whatever it was, and they got home later. But others in the community pitched in to help and to help those parents with children, to help raise their children. And that's a big part of what makes the fabric of who I am. And I think about that story every day. I'm in actually contact with the women who were girls a couple of years ahead of me, who were very helpful in helping me understand the importance of education through those after school kind of tutoring sessions. But that was just a responsibility that we took on. So I think those are the fabric, that's really a lot of the fabric of how I grew up.
My name is Candy Adioso. I'm from the class of 2022 at Eagle Staten Island. And Mr. Smith, there are many of us who are interested in becoming entrepreneurs themselves. In layman's terms, can you please explain to us what you do as the head of your company?
Sure, Candy, and thank you for that question. I am an asset manager. And what that means is I take assets, in this case, money, and I go and invest that money. I have developed a specialty of investing in, I call it enterprise software, but it's business software. So this is the software that runs banks, insurance companies, automobile dealerships, all forms of business software. And we have developed a very unique way of increasing the performance of those businesses so that they grow faster, they can acquire a company, or they can actually grow their revenues faster and make more profits. And then we sell those companies or we will take them public. So that's what I do. I buy companies, I fix them, I enable them, catalyze their growth, improve their operations, improve their technology, in many cases now implement artificial intelligence solutions into their products. And then we sell them for a profit. And we take that profit and return it back to our shareholders, the folks we got the money from. And then we take some portion of that profit for ourselves. I've been doing this for now 21, almost 22 years. We have had the highest returns in the world of private equity, I think in the history of private equity, and the lowest loss ratio. We lose very little money, less than 1% of the deals that we've done, we've lost money on. We manage money for the state of New York and the city of New York. And we're actually the highest returning private equity fund for the state of New York and the city of New York. So, and if any of your parents or relatives or people you know who have pensions, we manage a portion of their pension capital, and we do it quite responsibly. The way to really think about this is if New York City gives us $100 to invest, the next year, in essence, I deliver back $140. And in the next year, you know, another 40%, $180 on top of that. So we've been delivering, in essence, about 30, just under 40% internal rate of return or annual return to our investors for now over 20 years. And the important part of that is we take very seriously the money that we manage. The stakeholders of our business are, you know, city workers, teachers, firefighters, police officers, and realizing that they serve our community in different ways, what we want to do is ensure that we manage their pension capital well. The importance of that is it creates a value system that they can go do their jobs and we do ours. And as they retire, they have the ability to continue to support their retirement and their families. So that's what we do at Vista. That's what my firm does. I set it up over 21 years ago. And we continue to deliver those sorts of returns. To give you a sense, we now have a little over $70 billion of assets under management, about 70,000 plus employees. But realize over 60,000 of those employees are in essence STEM people. They are math and science people. I hire engineers, computer programmers, software developers and designers, and we deploy and develop solutions to solve problems in the world of business utilizing software. We operate in 173 countries, and we have over 2 million customers globally across all of those, including, I think it's 80% of the Fortune 500, and well over 225 million users of our software. Every single day, there are about 225 million people all around the globe who use our software to do their work. So in essence, that's what we do.
Good morning, Mr. Smith. My name is Demetrius Davis. I'm currently in ninth grade. I go to Eagle Academy, Brooklyn, and I'm class of 2024. Firstly, I would like to start off by saying thank you for being in our town hall this morning. It's an honor. As a highly successful Black man, tell us what a typical day is like in your life. What are some of your daily routines, and what do you do in your leisure time to relieve stress?
Demetrius, thank you for that question. It's a great question. In the mornings when I wake, I go into my I call it my session of prayer and meditation. I give thanks to God. I typically listen to some form of meditation. I will recite some part of scripture or read some scripture and think about filling my cup that day with the word of God. And I let that power me throughout the day. And I think that's an important ritual that I embrace. I do it often by myself. My four-year-old son now likes to do it with me, which is a lot of fun. And then we have time to talk about God and the meaning of God and what that means. And so I get to answer all manner of questions in the morning from him. And then I embark upon the day. And my day, because of the nature of my business, can go sometimes from 5 a.m. till, 11 o'clock at night. Last night I was on the phone with some investors in Korea and Taiwan. Tonight I think I've got some investors also, I think, in Asia and, the Middle East. I've got investors from all over the planet. Like I said, our companies operate everywhere. And I enjoy that dynamic. I enjoy the dynamic of engaging with different people who have different experiences in life. Oftentimes we engage on the matter of investing. So when I think about what I enjoy doing, I enjoy actually my business. I enjoy understanding investing in software. I enjoy coming up with products and solutions. I call them elegant solutions to complex problems in the world that I live in. And I find great joy in solving those problems. I also find great joy in terms of relaxing and listening to music. I used to play music. My father went to school on a band scholarship, so my home was always filled with music. So I try to keep my heart always filled with music, if not the room filled with music. I enjoy, in terms of sports and leisure activities, playing tennis with my family, badminton, play a little golf every now and then, and I'm an avid fisherman. I love the process. I fly fish. I fish everything, but I'm a fly fisherman for the most part. And I enjoy the process of getting in tune with nature. And hiking to places and fishing in that quietude, and frankly, enjoying and embracing all of God's glory of the outdoors. And I then look to provide that opportunity to as many people as I can, because I know the joy that I derive from that experience. And that is a good way for me to relieve stress. I like to read, listen to books on tape sometimes when my eyes are tired. But in essence, try to fill my mind again with thoughts and ideas. But that's a little bit of the cascading of the, that element, in addition to, making investments and talking with CEOs and solving problems on products and dealing with cybersecurity issues and so, all the other stuff that I do day to day.
Good morning, Mr. Smith. I'm Jordan Dodd from the class of 2025, and today I am representing Eagle Queens. Your story is amazing. It's phenomenal. I mean, you're living everybody's American dream. But my question to you is, as the wealthiest Black man in America, do you think that you still face similar obstacles that we may face as young men, as a father and an uncle? What keeps you up at night with all the things that are going on in the world right now?
Jordan, thank you for that question. That is a very insightful question. We live in a country that still has, in some cases, very strong vestiges of institutional racism that even I face every single day. And as a father of 3 brown boys and 3 brown girls, I worry about that. And I try to do everything that I can, not only to enable them to have less pressure of racism, but enable all Black people and brown people in America to have that as well. And I do what I can when I can, however I can. It keeps me up at night. I've seen just the vitriolic responses in many cases that parts of the American community have expressed towards creating equal opportunities for all Americans. And it disgusts me. And I think about what I can do about it. And like all things, you all have to think about what you can do about the world that you live in, the environment that you live in. And one of the most important things, and we talked a little bit about it earlier in this call, was think about how do you raise the younger brother, the middle brother, and as the older brother, as you evolve to that station. that's a big part of what you can do. You know, I tell people, you know, I have the ability through my work to actually do some things at scale that you won't have a chance to do for a while, but I expect all of you to do it at scale, at the scale that you can. You know, today your scale may be that you get a chance to read to a younger brother or sister, whether they're related or not, every day, and help them understand the importance of education, the importance of math, teaching them how to code, all those sorts of things. And if that's your contribution, you should do that every single day and take that on as part of, you know, your blessing to them in our community. And then as you get older, you'll probably be able to do it at a different scale in a different way. And you'll have to think about that and figure that out. But it is our responsibility and everybody on this call's responsibility to enable our community to be more successful, enable our community to participate in this economy more fully, you know, to destroy these vestiges of you know, institutional racism that exists at every opportunity, to protect each other. And while you may not agree with each other on everything, that's okay. You also need to understand that you need to work together to ensure that our community, again, thrives, not just survives. That's a big part of your responsibility. I have that same responsibility. I realize I have the ability to yield more resources against it. And so that's what I do. And so you should think about that every day, you know, utilizing whatever resources you have. And in many cases, you know, the most powerful resource you have is your mind and your heart. And the most important resource you have is your time. And so deliver that, and deliver that in a way that actually is, I'll call it inspired. Deliver that in a way that actually, you know, can be fulfilling, not only to you, but to the part of the community you're delivering it to, and make sure you deliver it in a way that is sustainable. You know, think about ways to create impact that will propagate and will resonate, so that it inspires others to do the same work or greater works than you may be capable of. That's a big part of what your mission is as an African-American male in this country. That is the joy that you must embrace and not view it as a burden. That's what your role is here in this land in this time.
Wow, extremely powerful words. I'm definitely taking my notes. I'm Ajani Patterson. I represent Eagle Brooklyn, and I'm class of 2021. Reading and gaining new information is paramount to the development of all young men. Is there a few books that you would recommend every young man should read that you think is critical to the growth of us, and why?
It's a great question. There are a number of books, and depends on where you are in your station as a In one case, you know, younger brother, middle brother, older brother. And then there's a station, which a friend of mine, Dr. Wood, calls, you know, the Jubilee man, which is over the age of 50, which I think there may be only four or five of us on this call. And every one of us have some work to do in what we read. I will tell you, one of the most prolific writers who actually helps you understand your power is Paulo Coelho. And one of the books that I recommend is one called The Alchemist. There's a book that he wrote before called The Pilgrimage. And you may want to read them in that order. But The Alchemist, I think, is an essential read for all of you in the K through 12 range. There's another set of books that I would point to, and while fiction, I think they're helpful to read, written by Guy Johnson. And Guy Johnson is the son of Maya Angelou, who hopefully you all know, Sister Maya, rest her soul. And he wrote a book called Standing at the Scratch Line. And another edition of that, the beginning is called The Echoes of a Distant Summer. And being from Colorado, being a cowboy at heart, and a Buffalo Soldier at heart, I think it's important that you all understand the diversity of who we are as African Americans in this country. And those books do a great job cascading across different parts in New York, Louisiana, you know, the Midwest, California, and gives color and texture to the diversity of who we are as a people and who we are as African-American males. And I think those are kind of a good set to start with. Some, again, they're fiction. And of course, you can always, and at some point you will have to read The Souls of Black Folk by W.B. Du Bois. You will likely get to those in college. His work, Langston Hughes's work, and Maya Angelou, of course, has just been a seminal person in expressing the nature of the African-American spirit. And I was just so taken by young Amanda Gorman at the inauguration, because she is expressing a lot of who we are in her poem from the inauguration, and I would recommend you reread that. So to give you some sense, I would those are some of the books that I would focus on.
Oh, good morning, Mr. Smith. My name is Justice Combis from the class of 2021, and I represent Eagle Academy for the Young Men of Harlem. And I'm sure I would speak for everybody when we say we are truly humbled to be virtually standing by, you know, a successful person of color like you. And I would say thank you. So my question is, Mr. Smith, what are the secrets to your success? And how can we follow you and your work on social media?
Secrets to my success. Wow, and Justice, thank you for that question. Most importantly, I like to say I live an inspired life, and it's inspired by God. And I was raised in a household that helped me understand the power of embracing God in all that we do. And then you have to follow God's hands, guidance as to what excites, you know, your mind and your heart for the work that you do. You know, I was led to technology. I was led to technology, and you know, you all on this call are all what we call digital natives. You know, you kind of grew up with a digital infrastructure in front of you in some respects. The real question is ensuring that you all have access to it, which is one of my personal missions that I'm focused on today. But I was a digital immigrant in that it really didn't get introduced into my life until high school. And, you know, I tell this story because actually it's a good story about a few things. You know, I was introduced to computers through one of my teachers in high school, and I asked, well, how does this thing actually work? And he told me it was run by this thing called a transistor. I said, well, who invented that? He said, oh, there was invented this place called Bell Laboratories. And you all wouldn't know about Bell Laboratories today much. But back in the day, there was one phone company, not the multiple ones you see, and they had a group called Bell Laboratories, and that's where a lot of the inventions that power the whole IT revolution that you were actually experiencing came out of Bell Labs. And I found out that they had a Bell Labs in Denver, Colorado, which is where I grew up. And I called them and I said, you know, I understand, I'm hoping you have internships. And they said, yes, we do. I said, terrific. And they said, if you're between a junior and senior in college, you should apply. And I said, well, I'm a junior in high school. I'm getting all A's in my AP classes. It's just like being in college. So, you know, where do I apply? And the human resources person, she said, you don't. You should apply when you're a junior in college. So I called her every day for 2 weeks. She stopped taking the call after the second day, but I left a message. And then I literally called her every Monday for about 5 months and left a message. And then she gave me a call back in June, 5 months later, and said, listen, a student from MIT didn't show up to our program. We have an extra slot. We're not saying you're getting the job, but you know, you can come and interview. And at the time I had, you know, one suit to my name, and I put on my one suit and At that time, I got $2 worth of gas and put it in my car, and I drove out there and I interviewed and I got the job. And it changed my life. It exposed me to a world of technology that I otherwise wouldn't have seen in my neighborhood and may not have seen, you know, the rest of my life had it not been for that internship. And that's why internships are so important to me. Why we built the InternX platform, which you all should look at internx.org and become a part of as you get into college. I think we now have over 12,000 STEM students on that platform and over 170 business partners who offer internships to our students. And the exposure to be able to see it. You know, there wasn't a me for me to see when I was your age. I didn't know any Black engineers. One engineer, African American, was a friend of my dad's. He was actually a draftsman. He was actually an engineer. And so I didn't know who to ask about what engineering was all about and where to go. But when I walked into Bell Laboratories, I actually shared rooms with a guy. His name was Vic Hauser. He was what they called a distinguished member of technical staff. He had about 35 patents to his name, had a PhD in solid state physics, you know, undergraduate in chemical engineering, one of the most brilliant people I'd ever met. And I shared offices with him every day. And he taught me something that I live with. And this is the question about what made me successful. One of the lessons that he taught me was the joy of figuring things out. And I tell my kids that there's only three things I'm gonna leave them. They get disappointed when I say that. But one of the things I hope to leave them is the joy of figuring things out. And every day, you know, when I started, he said, we've got a problem. We're trying to understand why this device, it was called an operational amplifier, is not working. It's used in some of our products out in the field. And he said, your job this summer is to figure out why it's not working. And you've got the full resources of Bell Labs. You can ask me any question you want. The library is just down the hall. And come back to me when you have questions. Now, on the one hand, you know, you might think, man, that's kind of rude. But what he did was open my mind to helping me understand how to solve a problem. So the first thing I did was I took that operational amplifier. I went to the library and looked up what is an operational amplifier and what is it supposed to do? And then I came back the next day with a series of questions, and he would get on the whiteboard, and for, you know, 2 hours or whatever long it took, every question I would ask, he would answer. And he said, do you have any more questions? I said, nope, I'll be back tomorrow. Then that night I'd go figure out and learn some more and come back with another series of questions. And at the end of that summer, while I was only a high school student, I had the highest rated project response at the end of the summer, even though they were college students. And I learned in that process the joy of figuring things out, as opposed to people teaching and we're just telling you how to do something, learning how to unpack and uncover, you know, the secrets of how things work, and then to be able to make them operate better. So that's one of the keys that I always point to, but it requires work. It requires dedication. It requires diligence. It requires sharpening your mind. And in many cases, you actually have to build a new set of tools in order to solve one portion of the problem. And this kind of gets back to one of the questions of, you know, what do I do to unwind? I actually like, I said, solving problems. I find tremendous joy in deciphering and solving problems at scale.
Good morning, Mr. Smith. My name is Tracy Williams II. I'm from the class of 2021, representing Eagle Queens and Southeast Queens. And I just first off want to say thank you for your time. Actually, the final question, and I say thank you for just being here on behalf of the whole entire Eagle Academy community. So my question is, besides being a great investor, you are well known for your philanthropy. As a young man who wants to attend Morehouse College in the fall, I was very interested in your gift to the graduating class of 2019. Why do you think it's important to give back to your community? In what way can we give back to our communities as students now or in the future?
Thank you for that question, Troy. And I'm going to look forward to seeing you in that audience in Morehouse. It's a great college, and it is a place where some of the greatest African American minds and spirits have been able to sharpen themselves with each other and become leaders in our community in various ways. And every time I meet a Morehouse man, I'm impressed with what they've learned beyond the books about what their role and responsibility is as an African American male in this country. What you should do is exactly what we talked about earlier, which is figure out how you deliver what you know and your capability is back to your community. Like I said, in some cases, it might be just helping a young person learn to read or solve math problems or learn a language or learn how to code. And I emphasize that it's important that you all importantly understand that it is a digital economy that is before you, and you need to be experts, not really, really good, experts in areas in and around that digital economy to ensure that our community participates fully in what is the bounty of a digital economy that is global. It is here, it is now, it has actually accelerated. This pandemic has accelerated the embracing of technology. You know, working from home, not just as a student, but working from home as a business person has meant there has to had to have been an acceleration of the adoption of digital systems and tools in order to be effective. And you all need to think about how you participate in that ecosystem of opportunity. Understand things like, you know, managed service providers, which in essence, anyone on this phone can become an entrepreneur being a managed service provider. You're saying, well, Mr. Smith, what is that actually? Well, you actually become an IT expert and you start supporting the businesses in your community. It might be a grocery store, a beauty salon, a barbershop, a insurance agency, or whatever it might be in your, that they all need IT help. And there are systems out there. One of my companies we've taken public called Dotto. The ticker there is MSP, and you all should follow that ticker, MSP. I'll give you another one to follow of our public companies. And what we do is, you know, we find people. We've got over 40,000 MSP providers, which are often, you know, small businesses that support the IT services of, you know, a half a dozen or a dozen or 20, you know, companies. Make sure their computers are working, the internet's working, you know, they're leveraging the software, they've got backup solutions for their data, because not every company has the ability to do that, so they need to hire someone. Well, that's a great business to be in. You know, you're your own boss, there are solutions out there that you can use and leverage, and you can grow that business to be, you know, as large as Verizon in some respects, because in some respects, a big MSP provider is Verizon. So I would encourage all of you to think about how do you become entrepreneurs leveraging technical solutions as part of your construct. You know, we own another company called Jamf, and the ticker there is J-A-M-F. And what they do, and many of you have, you know, Apple devices, you know, you may have an iPhone or an iPad or whatever it might be, but in order for those systems to work in companies, there has to be some interface and some company that actually enables those Apple devices to work in a corporate environment where most of the devices, what we call Intel type devices. Well, Jamf is the only company that does that. In fact, Apple Computer uses it themselves. And that's one of our companies that we took public, and you should follow that on the stock exchange. JAMF is the ticker and MSP is the ticker for data. And you should just analyze and follow them and read. And someone's asking me, well, what, you know, where do we follow you on social media? You can find me on social media, which is great, but go look at these companies and understand what they do and understand how they participate in the economy and try to figure out how you build businesses like that or build businesses that support those sort of businesses that, that you can run on your own and build, you know, enterprise service businesses. And some of you maybe decide to develop and build products or applications that you can sell into those ecosystems. So from my perspective, I think, you know, the most important thing you can do, of course, is help, is educate yourself, educate your community, and then enable a reliance, your own reliance on your own skills to create businesses that enable our community to be more self-reliant economically. And that's what I would encourage every one of our Eagle, you know, students here to do. You know, I was just so encouraged on the, when I think about the power scores that, that Brother Mead talked about, it's important that you all take that as not only a challenge, but embrace the opportunity to be the best. And if you're not, give accolades to those who are and learn what you have to do to improve your scores. It's we all learn differently. We all approach life differently. And you know, not everyone can be in the top two or three or four, but that doesn't mean you don't celebrate them. You should, especially out of our community, but you should also figure out what you need to do to continue to improve your progress. And I would love to see you all continue to embrace that as a community of Eagle students. And then the next step, of course, is as you go into college and finish college, start to build businesses and infrastructure that supports IT infrastructure, that supports our community. So we have better access to education, better access to healthcare, better access to capital through the banking systems, better access to higher quality food and services for our community. And that's really what you should take on as your, you know, as your, you know, your task as young Black men going forward.
Yes, yes. Thank you so much, Brother Smith. Let me just say, so thank you. Thank you, thank you. Just
my pleasure, Brother.
Taking this time to be with us and sharing these jewels of wisdom. I don't even know that these young men fully appreciate right now in this moment just how fortunate they are. You're doing deals with people all over the world on a daily basis, and yet he took time to be with us. And he also, beyond sharing and being supportive to Eagle over these years, is laying down another opportunity for us to net today. So the special announcement that I want to make is that as we kick off on Monday, everybody, Monday begins Black History Month. And so today, Mr. Smith and his foundation are announcing a Black History Month essay challenge for all the Eagle Academy students. So starting Monday, you can see the screen. We want you to watch the entire Black History in 2 minutes series. So you can see it at blackhistoryin2minutes.com. Once you have watched all of the episodes, we want you to write a compelling 500 word essay on what the series means to you and how you would use what is learned to have a good life. You're gonna have until Friday, March 12th to submit your essay. It is a competition. On Wednesday, March 31st, Mr. Smith and his team will select 10 winners through his team at the Fund 2 Foundation. They're gonna select the 10 winners and each winner will receive a $1,000 Amazon gift card. So immediately following today's town hall, your principal will have all of the details to enter. It's gonna be very interesting to see out of our Eagle Scholars, those who have that level of determination that Mr. Smith talked about when he was going for that internship at Bell Labs, that dogged determination to go in and starting on Monday to be part of this challenge and then commit to writing and rewriting until you have it as absolutely the best you can be and submit yourself for this competition with an opportunity to win a $1,000 Amazon gift card. I can't wait to see how this unfolds. Thank you. Thank you, Brother Cedric, Principal Cedric Hall, to close us out.
Mr. Banks, thank you very much. And if it's okay, Mr. Smith, I'm gonna go ahead and take the handling you referred to, Poet Angelou and Principal Meads. I'm gonna say, Brother Robert, thank you very much for being here with us this morning. I'm stuck, right? I'm not a guy that's a loss of words, but I'm a little stuck. I'm still trying to figure out and bring my anxiety down from choosing the right power tie for today's message, right? The thing that's really important, and you've mentioned it, and Brother Rashad talked to it, right? That the child stages, right? So Eagle scholars typically are in that middle child stage, right? You've got big brother above you, your Eagle educators talking to you, you got little siblings at home. The 6 through 12 is that age, right? Where you're kind of in the middle of things. But that is where that foundational piece really develops. Brother Robert, this wasn't a conversation about money all over the place, right? This wasn't that. This wasn't a money talk. This was a keys talk. He gave you those jewels and those foundations. He spoke about his struggles coming up. He talked about how that made him a stronger and a better, wiser person. He talked about his persistence with Bell. And you guys are too young to remember Bell Atlantic or Bell, but I remember Bell. There was a thick, they had the yellow pages. We had all the things. It was one big company. And I remember that company as a kid. I was on the latter end of it. But that persistence as a junior and his faith in God and his confidence enough to know, hey, I know I'm a junior in high school. I'm say that again, gentlemen, because I know we like to get comfortable in high school. A junior in high school, he didn't wait for college. He figured out the joy of figuring things out in high school. He understood that there's mechanics and content, but it's who you are as a person that catapults you into places of success. This wasn't a money talk, gentlemen. This was a keys talk. This was a personality talk. This wasn't a loud conversation. He's a very powerful man. You feel it through your computers. And he didn't yell, he didn't scream, he didn't flash a bunch of things. He was able to exude his power through poise because he understands that power doesn't come with volume, but it comes with actions and results. So 20, 21 years later, this man is sitting here with us. Everybody, by the time this thing is seen, we've got 1.3 on now. We're going to be talking tens of thousands. And not because he was loud, but because he was accomplished. And to be able to do so, that is the power, gentlemen. So, Brother Robert, thank you for being with us. Thank you for the jewels. Thank you for the keys. Gentlemen, so when I talk to you and your principal say, hey, you got a question, I need you to engage in the joy of figuring it out. Understand that that phrase is coming your way.
That's right.
Brother Robert, thank you again. Gentlemen, I know that we're going to leave with our charge of Invictus so that we can go as much as Brother Robert does with his morning ritual of filling his cup. This Invictus is going to fill our cup today and lead us on to our pathways of success. And we're not waiting for college. We're going to do it today and now while you have the opportunities of high school. General.
That's it. Yes, brothers, and as Principal Hall said, let's make sure that we recite this pledge of Invictus strong for the entire Eagle Nation to hear. Invictus straight.
Out of the night that covers me, black as the pit from pole to pole, I think whatever gods may be for my unconquerable soul.
In the fell clutch of circumstance, I have no winced nor cried aloud. Under the bludgeonings of chance, my head is bloody, but unbowed.
Beyond this place of wrath and tears, looms but the horror of the shade, and yet the menace of the years finds and shall find me unafraid.
It matters not how straight the gate, how charged with punishments the scroll. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul.
I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul.
Yes, brothers, we are the masters of our fate, captains of our soul. Again, fantastic town hall, brothers. Have a fantastic day. Have a fantastic weekend. And we look forward to seeing you next Friday. Eagle up.
All right.
Thank you guys. Next
up. Thank you, Mr. Smith.
And thank you, Mr. Smith.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Smith.
Thank you,
Mr. Smith. Thank you so much.